Hi, I'm Herb Millman.
And I'm John DeWire.
And we're the Deco Guys. Today we're here at our store in Lemberville, New Jersey at the Golden Nugget. We also have a store in New Hope, Pennsylvania called Cockamamie's. John?
Lambertville is where they have a wonderful flea market. It's one of the premier flea markets in the United States. And it's something that you probably should check out if you're looking for a really great deal.
Today we want to talk about several Art Deco items that we think you'd be interested in. Starting out with our radio lamp of Lady on the Waves, which is also on the cover of our very first book, Art Deco Lighting. We have a second book called Popular Art Deco Lighting, Shades of the Past, and we're currently writing our third. John, talk about the radio lamp a bit.
That was a shameless plug, but they're really good books, so you should buy them. Radio lamps, let me tell you a little bit about radio lamps. Radio lamps were very popular at the time of, during the 1920s and 1930s when radios were in every home. But what would happen when there would be a radio program, the family would gather around and they'd want to concentrate on the show, whether it was the Phantom or George Burns and Gracie Allen. Mm-hmm. They'd want to try and imagine what was happening. They wanted all the lights to be down so there wouldn't be any distractions inside of the room. And the radio lamp was a colorful way to light up the room just enough so that you could see around, but it would give a nice glow to the room so that you could use your imagination. This was before television, and they wanted to visualize inside of their own heads what was actually going on the radio.
So this lamp would sit on top of the radio, and it would be the only light in the room, and it gave off a great glow. And this particular one has Czechoslovakian glass, and she's called Lady on the Waves, and she's absolutely one of my favorite radio lamps that we have. Now, many of my clients will say, I love this type of lamp, but I don't know where to put it. I don't know where it's going to go. And I tell them, when you bring the lamp home, you walk around the house with this lamp, and it will find its own spot. You may have to move something, but it's going to find its own spot. And these radio lamps are very collectible. They were made back in the 1920s and 1930s. This particular one was made in the 1930s, and once again, she's called Lady on the Waves.
One other thing about this lamp is that the globe, a lot of times people think when they see another lamp that's just like it and they see a different globe, they think, oh, well, that globe isn't original to the lamp. But globes, when they were sold inside of the department stores of the time, you got to pick your own globe.
That's true.
So if you wanted to have a blue lamp, a blue globe or a different color globe to go with your decor, you could have that. Now, in this particular globe, the orange, I think, was particularly desirable because it made it look like fire was coming out of the.
That's true, and also it really worked very well on the book cover.
And this was actually also the precursor to the TV lamp, since people were used to having lamps on top of their radios to give light for the entire room. After everything was electrified and you had television, there still was this desire to, I guess, continue the tradition. But the TV lamps were made out of.
A lot of porcelain, a lot of parchment paper, and TV lamps would light from the back, so you wouldn't be distracted when you were watching the picture on the television. Mm-hmm. And radio lamps would light from the top because you were sitting in a dark room. And there's a very big market for television lamps and radio lamps, and here at the Golden Nugget, we have a lot of vendors that have a lot of TV lamps in their shops. One of our major collectibles is the 1939 World's Fair. We have many clients who collect it. There are tens of thousands of pieces that were manufactured for the 1939 World's Fair, and we brought a few pieces today which I know will interest you.
World's Fairs were events that were produced by countries so that they could feature what was wonderful about their architecture. You'd see these incredible pavilions that would be typical of what was actually going on in their country, and they would also show a lot about their culture. They would tell you about their culture and different kinds of industries that were going on in their countries. The 1939 World's Fair is rather significant. It actually started, in a sense, it started in 1935 because Grover Hansen, who was a retired police chief, said the Depression is getting too depressing. We need to do something here. We want to make sure that people don't go totally crazy. Let's have a World's Fair to celebrate us, to celebrate America, to celebrate New York. And they found a place that was an ash dump in Queens that was 1,200...
In Flushing, Queens.
In Flushing, Corona, Queens. It was 1,216 acres. And Robert Moses, along with the New York World's Fair Corporation, which was housed at the Empire State Building, designed the World's Fair, and it was the second largest World's Fair in America, the first being the Louisiana Purchase World's Fair at the beginning of the century.
However, in doing so, they decided to incorporate the world. So you had pavilions from every country, not just pavilions from the United States. It became a worldwide World's Fair.
And this was the first World's Fair, and this was another exciting part of this particular World's Fair. This was the first World's Fair that concentrated on the future. Most World's Fairs were just saying, oh, this is America, this is Portugal, this is Russia, this is wherever.
However, the Chicago 1933 World's Fair also had the future. That were very futuristic pavilions.
But that was an exposition. But this was the first World's Fair that actually was.
Oh, please.
Oh, please.
Okay.
But it was the first World's Fair that concentrated on the future. So okay. that was really significant.
Anyway, we brought some of our favorite pieces, and I'd like to take a few minutes to show you. This is a one-of-a-kind jewelry box that was made out of black mirror and silver mirror. There's a trilon and perisphere, which was the symbol of the 39 World's Fair, and every piece that I'm going to show you has a trilon and perisphere on it. But anyway, the jewelry box was designed of black mirror and silver mirror. When you open it up, it was hand-painted. This is a collectible, a one-of-a-kind piece, which goes for hundreds of dollars. They had autograph albums from high schools. This was a very popular piece that was sold at the World's Fair, but what they did is that they had different schools' names put in them. All the high schools throughout the United States, they made these albums for. So if a kid graduated from Taft High School or New Hope Solbury, whatever, the name of their school and a picture of their school was in the front of the book.
I didn't know that.
That's true. There were hundreds, literally hundreds of ashtrays made from the 39 World's Fair. Each one, of course, had the trilon and perisphere. Copper, glass, all types of metals, big tires. They were huge vehicle tires with a trilon and perisphere in the center. They had hundreds of ashtrays. Now, this is a fun piece. These are the views of the 39 World's Fair. It came in 100 views or 75 views, and there's little film strips in each box, and they gave you a little viewmaster. And believe it or not, after all these years, the film is still good. They've not disintegrated.
It's amazing that you've kept it ever since you were there in 1939, Herb.
I wasn't born yet, but I did see a picture of you in one of the views, sitting in one of the pavilions. Now, we have playing cards.
You were mistook.
We have playing cards. Once again, they made hundreds of different decks. They made large decks, small decks. They even have some with pinups on them from the 39 World's Fair. And the collectible plate, there are hundreds of collectible plates, all different types. They're all signed on the back. And this is one of my favorite ones because it has the pavilions bordering the entire plate. Now I'm going to show you something from my personal collection. This is a Social Security card, a metal Social Security card that had the trilon and perisphere emblazoned on it with the individual's name.
Herb Millman.
With the individual's name, I'm just ignoring him, and their Social Security number. The other thing that I had for my personal collection is a wallet. And in this wallet is an ID card of an employee who worked at the 39 World's Fair, his photo, his ID number, and then they gave them a bunch of tickets. And these tickets would allow the employee to go to the various pavilions. This is just a sampling of the tens of thousands of pieces that are available to the 39 World's Fair. And many of them are available here at the Golden Nugget Flea Market in the building, at the Golden Nugget South, we call it, and also in our store at Cockamamie's in New Hope.
One of the reasons that there were so many wonderful items from the New York 1939 World's Fair was because prior to this, a lot of the World's Fairs were just countries showing, this is what my architecture is, this is what my culture is about, but there wasn't a whole lot of merchandising. But because it was it was during the Depression, there was, there was a bit of an argument. Albert Einstein wanted the entire fair to be more scientific oriented, but he didn't win, and he and some other scientists wanted that, but they didn't win out, and instead it became more of a fair where there was a lot more merchandising, a lot more wonderful.
Well, the merchandising
like
also
this.
Paid for the construction of the fair. Mm-hmm. I mean, because they so, but of course, something like this may have gone for 85 cents. Back in the day, now it goes for a couple of hundred dollars. Now we're going to talk about one of my favorite subjects, chaseware. There's a lot of chase out there. There are a couple of thousand pieces, different styles. John, you want to give a little bit of background on chase?
Well, Augustus Chase started the chase manufacturing. Well, actually, it wasn't called the Chase Manufacturing Company. It was called Waterbury. It's called Waterbury Manufacturing Company, and they were out of Waterbury, Connecticut. And it became the Chase Brass and Copper Company later in the 19th century. And once we got to the 20th century, Rodney Chase came up with the signature Chase emblem, which was a centaur with a bow and arrow. That was done actually in 1928, and in 1930 to 1942, they have their signature chrome houseware accessories. And this was really what put Chase on the map. And you would find these pieces in many department stores and jewelry stores and in their own Chase shops. One of the exciting things about collecting Chase is that you're also collecting incredible designers of the time. Walter von Nessen, Rockwell Kent, Russell Wright, they all designed for Chase, as did many other designers. So that's another exciting element of Chase. There's a Chase catalog, but there are some pieces that were not marked Chase, but still were Chase, and people keep discovering new pieces of Chase all the time. That's one of the reasons that it's exciting to collect it, because you think that you've seen everything, and then all of a sudden there'll be a piece that most likely will have the Chase marking, but not always, and you'll know it as Chase, and you'll go, wow, I didn't even know that they had this out there.
Chase is one of the most desirable collectibles today. I can't tell you how many people come in our shop here and in New Hope and ask, do you have any Chase merchandise? You know, we always carry Chase.
You know, something that I'm originally from the Midwest. I'm from Michigan. I had never seen blue glass before. Mm-hmm. And I love the blue glass element of Chase. Mm-hmm. And I just love the elegance, too, because out in the Midwest, you don't get this much.
They are very elegant looking pieces. And they're very simple, straight lined, and very elegant looking.
You'd see them mainly in large, their line was mainly carried in large cities in the large department stores,
right.
So it has a very urban sense to it. And you didn't always get that out in the Midwest, but you did see it in Hollywood. They had their own shops in Hollywood. They had actually a shop in Portland, Oregon, in New York.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
and A&S. Every
A&S
store had one. Now, every piece of Chase does have their mark on the bottom of it. But let's start. This is a copper candlestick with a Bakelite insert. These are great. This is a cream and sugar from made by Chase with Bakelite accents. They were very big in using Bakelite and cobalt blue, but they predominantly made all their pieces of chrome. This is a cigarette holder with a cobalt blue insert. And then you have drinking goblets with a cocktail shaker here. The cocktail shaker is signed on the bottom. The shaker is great because you've got your strainer in here. I mean, these were very, very popular in their day. The funny thing is that these things would cost about 35 cents back in the 1930s, and now they go for hundreds of dollars a piece. We've got salt and pepper shakers. You've got candy dishes. You even have a silent butler with a Bakelite handle and bud vases. They came out with thousands of pieces. They made a lot of lamps, a lot of serving pieces, a lot of household accessories. And here at the Golden Nugget, there are dealers that do carry Chase merchandise.
Chase, I love Chase. One of the things that a lot of people don't know is that when Chase did come out, Emily Post got involved actually with the product line. And she was promoting it because she loved the idea of the housewife giving up parties and being the hostess. And they had bun warmers and different kinds of items so that the housewife could go around and entertain.
Candy dishes, trays, a lot of trays and candy dishes.
And so everything could look very, very elegant. And she could go and make the wonderful meal for everybody and still have a buffet. Emily Post was putting out the idea of the buffet as a way to entertain, have everything out there for people in these elegant Chase bun warmers and other carrying dishes that Chase would provide.
And once again, the three elements that they used were chrome predominantly, copper, and brass. That was it.
And one of the reasons that it only lasted until 1942 was because of the war. At that point in time, it shut down. Chase is still with us as a company in Ohio, but now they're making brass rods.
But I should also tell you that back in the 1939, every Abraham and Strauss store had a Chase outlet. They had some of their own stores in Manhattan, in New York, and in Los Angeles, But every A&S had a Chase booth, and they only sold Chase merchandise at A&S.
What we have here is a 1940s English bar. These bars that were in many English homes were very, very popular. They often were in their den or living room, sometimes in their cellars. Years ago,
what were they called?
Cellarettes. Actually, this is a we have pop-up bars, but we also have there were cellarettes. Cellarettes were in the 1700s, and they were a place to store your wine. Often they were marble. Mm-hmm. They eventually became wood during the 1800s. Once you got into the Victorian times, people were keeping their liquor in their Victorian sidebars. But then, what came back in vogue were bars such as this. Mm-hmm. They were very popular during the 1920s and 1930s in England, especially as America was having prohibition. They were having, the English were not having tea, they were having a little drink with their tea.
Mm-hmm. We have a tremendous number of these English bars and pop-up bars, even here at the Golden Nugget Antique Shop. So.
This is really wonderful.
This is a wonderful piece. Ooh, there's a drink in there.
A drink, oh my gosh.
Oh, look at this.
Already poured. What is it, Cosmo?
We'll find out.
Chin chin.
To you.
But how wonderful is this?
Put all your glassware here, your stemware. And you have a shelf for glasses. And you would put your liquor bottles here. And on the bottom, there's a tremendous amount of storage. Of course, we use everything for storage, but for liquor bottles and glasses.
What's great, too, is this just appears like a an ordinary piece of furniture. And then you open it up. You see that it's a party in a box.
It's a party in a box. And it's very utilitarian because when it's closed, you can, I mean, first of all, if you're having a party, you have a serving surface up here as well. But when you close it up, put a vase of flowers on it, and it sits in your living room or your dining room.
I'll drink to that.
I'll drink to that. Thank you.